get done this morning here. It is our prayer and desire that each one of us who have come today would be here to worship our Lord Jesus Christ, because He is risen, and we want to remember that glorious morning, and more importantly, we want to celebrate that. Do you remember the words that the angel spoke to the women when they went to the tomb early in the morning on the first day of the week, which of course is Sunday morning? These are the wonderful and awesome words the angel said to the women. Listen to these words. "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him." Aren't those wonderful words? He is not here. He is risen. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, a quick test of your memories. I know many of you have been to these sunrise services over the years. Just want to see if you remember this. The Lord, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Okay. I was going to tell you, but I'm going to ask somebody who might be out there can tell us, where's that come from? Anybody remember the history of this phrase back and forth? Anybody remember? Way back in the early days, after Jesus had ascended back into heaven, this became a way of greeting among the early disciples. Instead of saying, "Hey, how are you?" or "What's up?" you know, they would say from one Christian to another, "The Lord, He is risen," and then he would affirm that by saying back, "He is risen indeed." So let's try that again with enthusiasm. This is Easter morning, right? The Lord, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. And that's why we're here this morning. I just want to say at this point that we'd like to invite all of you to stay for the breakfast, which will be served right after the service. We'll start in the fellowship hall, and that fills up. We have seating already set up in the library as well. We ask you that you just find your seats, and the teams will be serving you. The only exception is if you want coffee, we're going to ask you to go to the table set up in the front of the fellowship hall to get your own coffee, so that way you can make it how you would like it to be, and you won't get spilled on. So we don't want any accidents. But other than that, go find your seats, and the teams will take care of you then. Also, during the service, we will be receiving an offering, which will help offset the costs for breakfast. So we want you just to be prepared for that if you could. And then also, I just want to mention that following breakfast this morning, right at 9:30, will be Sunday school. There's something for all the age groups. We want to invite you to stay. And then following Sunday school at 10:40 will be our worship service. And we just want to invite you and encourage you to join us for the entire morning. And then also, being Easter, there will be no evening service tonight. At this time, I invite you to please bow with me for a word of prayer. Father God, we're so grateful that we can be here this morning. We're just so delighted to know that you have sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into this world. And Jesus, we thank you that you came down and that you were willing to pay the price for us in Calvary. You were willing to be nailed to that cross to take up our sins, even though you knew no sin and you were perfect in every way. And we're so thankful that death was not able to contain you, but that you rose again on the third day. And Lord, we give you thanks for that. And we just want to worship you this morning. We want to give you the glory that you deserve. We pray that you would just be pleased with all that's said and done this morning. We pray that you would just guide and direct all that's said as well. And Lord, we just want to thank you and let you know how much we truly love you and appreciate you. This is your day, and we're here to worship you. For it's in your name we pray together. Amen. The Lord, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen.
Carefully to these words from Psalm 145. "I will exalt you, my God the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of his praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. They will speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. And I will meditate on your wonderful works. They will tell of the power of your awesome works. And I will proclaim your great deeds. My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord. Let every creature praise his holy name forever and ever." You know, when we meditate upon the mighty acts of God, We are truly amazed and moved at the power of our God. He is awesome and worthy of our praise. When we allow these thoughts to take root, we cannot help but desire to worship Him, to love Him, and to honor Him. No matter what we're going through, how we're feeling, or any other concerns we may have, we need to continuously give God praise and glory. He and He alone is worthy of our worship all the time. Think about Paul and Silas in prison for their faith. Yet we see them praying and singing to God at midnight. If we desire to experience true joy and peace with God, we need to learn to praise Him and trust Him all the time. This morning, this glorious morning, provides us another opportunity to do just that.
Worship and praise God this morning together as we raise our voices to sing. Let's take our hymnals and open to page 44. The song is entitled Over a Thousand Tongues. Let's all stand and worship God together.
Oh,
day is as important to our faith as water is to the ocean. No water, no ocean. No resurrection, no Christianity. No hope and no reason to believe. 1 Corinthians 15:17 makes that point clear. And if Christ had not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. But fortunately, we do have reason to believe. We do have reason to celebrate, and certainly we have hope that goes beyond this life and into all eternity. Jesus said in John 2:19, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." To this the Jews replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After Jesus was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Jesus said he was going to rise from the dead, and you know what? He did. Praise God, death could not contain him. But in order for Jesus Christ to be raised from the dead, he had to die. Why did this have to happen? I have a story that will help to answer this question. There was a young woman stopped by a policeman for driving 55 in a 35-mile-per-hour zone. When she appeared before the judge, she admitted that she was guilty. The judge fined her $100, then took off his robe, stepped down from his bench, and paid the fine out of his own wallet. The judge was also the girl's father. She had indeed broken the law, and was a good judge. He had to penalize her, but he loved her so much that he was willing to pay the fine for her. This story helps to illustrate God's love for people. As a just God, he had to penalize us for our sin, and the punishment for sin brings death, eternal death. But as our loving Father, he paid the penalty for us and offered us a life of freedom by sending Jesus to die in our place. This happened so that in Jesus Christ, we might be made righteous. It's nothing we deserved or have earned. It is simply the wonderful and amazing grace of God. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
transitioning into the next part of the service. Shannon is going to be coming and singing a vocal solo. And after the vocal solo, we will be receiving the offering for the breakfast this morning.
Reaching out.
Thank you, Shannon. That song was entitled God So Loved the World, and I hope you enjoyed that and were able to catch most of the words. At this time, as we said earlier, we will be serving breakfast right after the service today. Whether or not you came prepared to help contribute a little bit to offset the cost of breakfast, we still want to invite you to stay. After the service, we invite you to go back to the fellowship hall, and if that fills up, we want to ask you to move on down to the library, as we have seating there as well. We have some ushers prepared. I want to invite the young men to come at this time. And as they're coming, I just want to say that for the offertory today, Jen Scott will be playing a French horn solo, and this is one that she's played for solo and ensemble contest. Let's bow together for prayer. Lord, again, we thank you for this privilege of being here. We again want to just glorify you, even through our giving. We pray that you'd help us to be generous as we give. And we pray you'll help Jen as she plays her song and do the best she can for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Teams have put together a skit entitled A Recipe for a Resurrection, so we hope you enjoy it.
Move on.
There is a group of disciples looking very downcast and hopeless.
mourning the death of their Lord and friend Jesus.
Meanwhile, back in the garden.
What's the matter?
They have taken my Lord away and I don't know where they have put him. Sir, if you have taken him, please tell me where he is.
Mary?
Teacher!
Hold on, Bob, for a moment. Go instead and give a message to my disciples and I will return to our Father. Go.
That's what she did.
Hey, James! Peter! Thomas!
What is it?
Yeah, nothing, Sammy. I'm scared the life out of you.
Is this important? We are kind of busy being miserable here. Everyone has seen Jesus. He's alive. He's risen. He has.
Mary, that's not funny.
It's not meant to be funny. It's wonderful.
You feeling all right?
Have you been out in the sun too long? Come on, fellas. I'm telling you. Jesus is alive.
Now listen, Mary. We all know he is very dear to you.
And he still is. He's a...
Let me finish. And dear to us. But you must start to face the facts. You yourself saw him die.
And I saw him this morning, risen. Come on, Mary. You don't expect us to believe that, do you?
That's what we're doing today, isn't it?
What do you mean, saw?
I saw him, okay?
No, it's not okay.
He even gave me a message for you. Unless I see the nail marks on his hands and put my hand on his side, I will not believe it.
Look, Mary, we all saw him die, and you're the only one who's seen him risen, so you say.
We've seen the Lord. We've seen the Lord.
What?
Hold on, there must be some left.
There is. He's risen. Not again. I will not believe it. Unless I see the nail marks on his hands and put my hand on his side, I'm not going to believe it.
Thank you, Thomas.
Where did you see him?
Today, we saw him on our way to our hometown, Emmaus. He started to just appear to us on the road and started talking to us.
Only we didn't know it was him.
Until later, when he broke the bread in our house.
And we asked him to stay the night with us.
But then he just vanished away.
And we thought we'd better tell him.
The Lord is risen. I believe.
I can't believe it.
We all saw him die.
Unless I see.
No, Thomas. And there we have a recipe for a dead faith.
Take a hard-hearted person
that hasn't met the risen Jesus
and doesn't believe those who have
and doesn't want to anyways.
Put them in a life with no beliefs.
Take a tomb if you like and roll a stone carefully over the entrance
and leave them.
They die, of course.
Of course.
And some do.
But Jesus is into resurrection.
Peace be with you.
Hello, my friends. Didn't you believe? Didn't I tell you that I'd rise from the dead? Thomas, see my hands? Put your hands into my side, Thomas. Stop doubting. Believe.
My Jesus, my Savior.
Blessed are those who have not seen, but believe anyway. Go into all creation and preach the good news to everyone.
So they went.
And they preached.
They baptized.
They healed.
They taught.
They were persecuted.
Some were martyred.
They were obedient.
They believed.
Do you?
I was a stand-in this morning as one of our young people couldn't be here this morning. They had a crisis at home, so excuse me for being dressed up like this as I share, but I just have a few closing comments I would like to add here at the end. Not going to be long, but I just want to say that Romans 10, verses 9 and 10 say that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. Did you get that? To be saved, one must not only confess that Jesus is indeed Lord, one also must believe that God raised him from the dead, that he indeed is alive. As a non-negotiable, it can be no other way, that Jesus Christ is alive, and that is why we are here today. This leads to the inevitable question, that is, do you believe that he rose again and is alive? This is a question that we all must answer, and if we desire to spend eternity in heaven with God, then it must be answered in the affirmative. It was obvious that 8-year-old Stephen's mental retardation was becoming even more severe. His Sunday school teacher did her best to include Stephen in the classroom activities and to avoid situations that would prompt his classmates to make fun of him. In April, she gave each of the 8 children in the class an empty pantyhose container. It was in the shape of a plastic egg, and instructed them to place inside the container an object that represented new life and spring. So the children would take these eggs home and bring them back the following week. Fearing that Stephen might not have caught on and not wanting to embarrass him, the teacher had the children place all the containers on the desk so that she could open them. The first one had a tiny flower in it. "What a lovely sign of life," the teacher said. One of the students couldn't help but erupt and said, "I brought that one." Well, next came a rock. The teacher assumed that this must be Stephen's, since rocks don't symbolize new life. But Billy shouted that his rock had moss on it, and moss represented new life. "Well, very good," agreed the teacher. What a butterfly flew from the third container. Another child bragged that their choice was the best of all. Then came the fourth container. It was empty. "Well, this must be Stephen's," thought the teacher, quickly reaching for a different one. "Teacher, please don't skip me," interrupted Stephen. "But it's empty, Stephen," said the teacher gently. "That's right," said Stephen. "The tomb was empty, and that represents new life for everyone." Well, later that summer, Stephen's condition worsened, and he died. And at his funeral, on his casket, mourners found 8 pantyhose containers, all of them empty. And this is a true story. And it's a reminder of the hope that we have because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:22 tells us that as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. Prior to raising Lazarus from the dead, Jesus was engaged in a conversation with Martha, one of the sisters of Lazarus. Martha had said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had only been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to Martha, "Your brother will rise again." Well, Martha responded with those words, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." And this is where Jesus states those powerful words, often quoted at funeral services. But it would do us all well to remember these words on a more regular basis. Because listen to these words that Jesus responds. He says to Martha, as well as to Mary, and to all of us, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." Then he asked her, and he asked us, "Do you believe this?" Well, Mary responded in the affirmative. Again, Martha, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world." What is your response? Because each one of us must answer that question. Do you believe? Do you believe that Jesus is the resurrection and the life? And that anyone who believes in him will live, even though he dies? I want to encourage everyone to consider where they stand in response to this all-important question. You see, our sins were bought and paid in full at Calvary, while our future was secured in the resurrection. All we must do is believe and accept this gift that God offers to each one of us. Remember in Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9, it says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. It is not from ourselves, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. It's by God's grace through our believing that we're saved." The empty tomb had a message for the disciples, as it had for us as well. In fact, the empty tomb says to science and philosophy, explain this event. It says to history, repeat this event. It says to time, blot out this event. And it says to faith, believe this event. Back to Romans chapter 10 and verse 9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Folks, that is the key, is believing and accepting the fact that Jesus Christ is alive. That is why we're here this morning. And as Holly read in one verse from 1 Corinthians 15, if Christ is not risen, our faith is useless. We're still in our sins. You know, it's all for naught. But Christ is alive, hallelujah, and that is why we're here, and that's why we need to have a sense of victory, you know, every single day, knowing that Christ is with us. We're going to sing here in a moment. I need Shelly to get in here. I know she's in the back. Shelly? Shelly? We are going to do a hymn number 100. We're going to just sing the first verse. It's a song of... You know, you can't help but color this song out, especially if you believe it, and I hope you all do. Because if you truly believe that Jesus Christ is alive, I want you to sing out this this stanza. We're going to just do the first verse, and I want to encourage you that if you have come today with questions, or maybe you're not a believer at this point, I really, truly invite you to talk to me or to Pastor Bilza after the service, or any of the elders, or any of us who may be you know, there at the breakfast time. We don't want you to leave not understanding and not believing. Because, folks, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Before you stand, I just want to remind you again that breakfast will be served right after we sing. After breakfast, there will be Sunday school for all the age groups. And then at 10:40 will be our worship service. And again, we want to invite you to please feel welcome to join us for the whole morning. Let's now all stand together as we sing the first verse of Christ the Rose, number 100. Hopefully you'll enjoy breakfast. I'm sure you will. And just want to thank everyone that made this possible, those that volunteered to help do